Good morning again for some. Just a word of warning, this is a much lighter session than the one before where we tackled FreeSphere DSC, for the ones that were here in the previous one. This is a very light one. We are going to look at some visualization of vSphere performance data. Don't expect any deep dives in here. We're just doing some very superficial stuff. Show a few methods how we can obtain vSphere performance graphs. And in the end, there's a bit of a new thing that I've been working on in the last couple of weeks, containers. And normally it was not in there, but I will explain you why later on that I added it yesterday evening instead of boozing all over the place. Okay, there's a few things when you want to visualize your performance data. First of all, you have to be able to get the data. There are some common techniques that we use, purely PowerShell. Then when you have the data in a manageable format, you have to present it in a graphical format. And that's what we'll be showing with a couple of examples here. And then the containers, I already mentioned in the beginning, but that's a bit of a surprise page that I will add at the end. Getting the data, like I said in the previous session where we were talking about vSphere DSC modules, you have to know your environment. It's a bit the same here. If you want to collect performance data from your vSphere environment, you have to understand how this data is kept in your vSphere environment. So there's a few basic concepts that you have to be well aware of. First of all, it's all your hypervisors, the ESXis, that are collecting that performance data. That's what we call real time. That's where you have all the metrics available and they are kept there for approximately an hour. So if you want to have a lot of information, you fetch it from your ESXi host, not from the vCenter. What the vCenter does, at certain intervals, he picks up that data, and preferably faster, around an hour, because otherwise it would be lost. He transfers it from the ESXi to the vCenter, and once it's on the vCenter, he will aggregate that data, meaning on the ESXi node, your intervals of measurement are 20 seconds. Once you're on the vCenter, he will aggregate those 20-second intervals into respectively 5 minutes, 30 minutes, 2 hours a day. That has a consequence. If you look at performance data from your vCenter and you look further than a day in the past, the granularity of your data will be very coarse. I mean, you don't see all these nice CPU peaks anymore. You will have one value for one day, which is nice if you want to do capacity planning, but that's not nice if you want to analyze an issue. Who was causing a blockage at our XYZ on that day? For that, you need to have the more extended data that you would be able to get from your hypervisors in this case. So you need to know a bit of this concept here, how that performance data is collected, where it is kept, and what vSphere, more specifically vCenter, is doing with your data. This is what I already mentioned. So the real-time one, the one sitting on your ESXi nodes, is having the most granularity. But it's also having most of the metrics that you want or don't want. Depends what you're looking for. Now, if you want to go for all the metrics and you want to collect that every hour from your all your ESXi nodes, be warned that this contains or will produce a lot of data. Make sure you have ample storage space available to store all that data. Sorry. Also, make sure that you can identify where it was collected. So have a file name with a meaningful name and be able to retrieve the timestamp and so on. At first sight, without actually going into the file. Also, make sure that you know what is actually there. So don't assume that you have everything. Do a regular check. If you collect data, check what is in there. What I often use when I collect data or when I have a big bunch of data somewhere, there is a way of getting the start and the end of the data in a specific file. So this is just a quick script where I will see what the oldest and the most recent data in that file is, how many rows I have in there. And as you can see, there's only an hour that we captured in here, and this already produced more than 500,000 rows of data. So be warned, this produces quite a bit. Also notice the metrics at the bottom, that's 195 metrics. Each of these is a specific measuring type. It could be CPU average, but it could also be your network transmitted bytes number. And on top of that, for each or a lot of these metrics, you have multiple instances. So the instances, not always, so you can't just multiply those two numbers, but a lot of the metrics have multiple instances. So that's something that you should be aware of as well. Now, the metrics, as you know, they are all documented in the vSphere API SDK reference under the Performance Manager, but you can get them yourself. There is a very handy Power CLI commandlet, which most of you probably know already. That's the get stat type here on the middle lines. And this is an example. If you want to never forget a metric anymore in your collection of data, just ask get stat type what is there, collect all those in an array, which is my array stat here, and then you call your statistics in this line and you just specify all the metrics that you collected before with the get stat type. I only did it for two types of entities, for VMs and for hypervisors. There are more entities, so I'm not having all the metrics here already, but this is one way of doing it. If you want data store is a bad example. If you want networks, for example, you would need to add eventually, or cluster information, you would need to collect those types as well. But be warned, cluster metrics most of the time are aggregated metrics, so they are not available in real time, only on the vCenter. Some things, this is again a very basic concept, do not always assume that you're using the best method when you're collecting data. So what is obvious, we are get stat and we do an export to a CSV file. Later on, we do an import CSV. Everything, this is the fastest way to do this kind of stuff. It's not. CSV, import CSV is doing a lot of stuff that you don't suspect, but it is happening under the cover. So there's quite some overhead involved that you don't necessarily need for what you're using it. So as we can see later on, there's a bit of profit. For your one-off jobs, your occasional jobs, this is not a real problem. But if you have to do something quite extensive and on a repetitive scale, it would be handy if you could look at alternative ways of looking at your data. One important note here at the bottom, never forget anymore, if you do an import CSV, that all your columns are strings. There are no date times, there are no integers, there are no other types. It's all strings. You'll see later on why this is important to remember. And there's a quiz after the session. No, seriously. Okay, this is the code where I test two types of importing my data. You see the top five lines with the comment line is the standard one that I would do top of my head, import, export, CSV. This is quite straightforward. What I'm doing here is I'm reading a big file. I'm checking if I'm extracting all the statistical data between two time points in time, and I'm writing it to another CSV file. Now, this looks quite straightforward. Everybody would do it. I would do it like that if I don't have to think about it. But there's another way. You can use the stream writer. Now, what you have to do is you need to do a lot more coding, as you can see here. You're going into the older .NET methods, but in the end, it's a lot faster if you do it that way. We're looking at, for example, the timestamp. There's some things you need to know, which Power CLI would be ideal for you. I know that the timestamp is in the second column. Remember I said when you read something from a CSV, it's always a string, so I have to cast it explicitly into a date time to be able to compare a start and a finish date for the one record that I'm reading there. Now, if we look at the results, if we do a run on this, on a very straightforward CSV file, there's quite some difference. The top one is the import-export CSV, and the bottom one in green is the... That's nearly three times as fast. So, and this is only the small file that we saw earlier. I'm writing away 150,000 nearly records, which is not a lot, but there's an important time difference in execution between two of those methods. So if you have to do this for a lot of data, it would be handy if you, for example, sometimes reconsider, am I actually using the fastest, best method? It's not the most obvious coding, but it's worth your while to improve and optimize your code that you're using. Now, this is a PowerShell conference. We want to do most of our stuff with PowerShell, of course. And if you're working with statistical data, PowerShell is very fit for the job. If you have big data, then of course you better look at the third-party application. But if you have your occasional data that you yourself want to do, there are a lot of built-in commandlets in the standard PowerShell that will help you enormously. And I think those are just the four more important ones that I consider if you're working with statistical data. There's the obvious select, you can sort stuff, you can group stuff, which is very handy if you're working with lots of data. And you can do measurements. Instead of making yourself a script for calculated minimum, maximums, averages, there is a commandlet that does all that for you. So don't reinvent the wheel, just use what is there. I'm just doing a couple of examples here that for those of you that are not using those commandlets that often, this is a very typical example. You have a bunch of statistical data and you want to see how many entities, in this case, objects in a vSphere environment are present in your statistical data. Use the group object commandlet and your result will show you immediately what you have available. There's obviously five VMs with a number of metrics in there, and there's two hypervisors in that data. So we immediately have knowledge of what is in our data. If you would be looking at the raw data in Notepad++ or whatever, this wouldn't be that obvious from just glancing at the data. So quite handy to explore before you actually start charting. This one, this is the quiz I mentioned earlier. Why does this fail? Anybody, any idea? Because this is obviously not what we want. What we wanted to do here is on that statistical data, I want to have per minute the number of metrics I have in that file. Now, this is the only remark, don't forget that I made earlier on. Your timestamp is a string in this case. You can't compare a string in that property. So you have to, and that's why we see everything come back as one big blob with all the observations in there. If you want to actually interpret the date at the timestamp and look at the minutes, you would have to do it this way. And what we're doing here is actually converting, casting that string that is in timestamp into a date time, and then we can take the minute of that timestamp. So now we get a clear view per minute of how many observations we have in that group of performance data. So quite important to know about import that we're working with strings. Quick example of the measure object commandlet. There's a number of built-in statistical functions in there. One of the obvious one is the average. So we're now looking at one specific metric, in this case, CPU usage average, for one specific VM. And we're looking, or we're asking, what is the average over the complete time frame that we have in our performance data. So very handy built-in commandlet works without a problem. So don't reinvent anything, just use what is there. Where's the graph? I know this session was titled Visualizing, so we haven't seen any visuals or graphs yet. What I wanted to do is, I just wanted to give you an idea of the data. That's what I did. Remember how the data is kept in your vSphere environment. Some of the basic techniques, built-in commandlets that you can easily or should use for working with your statistical data. Once you have that and you know how to explore your data, then you can start doing the graph. Now, don't try, in my opinion, don't try to write your own thing from the base up. There's a lot of stuff around that you can easily reuse, adapt, and it produces quite helpful visualizations of your vSphere performance. I will give you some examples in the following slides. First, we go retro. We have ASCII art. So you can do this. There's even a module on the market available, but it's not in the PS gallery. I think the guy was too ashamed to publish it there. But you can do it this way as well. Now, of course, I'm just kidding here, but I mean, you could look at this kind of representation of your performance data, but we can do a lot better. There are other options available. And I'm not pretending in this session that I'm looking at everything that is available there, but I just pick out a couple of them that seem quite interesting for me. First of all, there's who knows MS Chart from the past? Anybody ever used MS Chart? Okay, MS Chart was a kind of a software tool that you installed on your Windows platform, and it allowed you via a COM object to do some coding and produce some graphs in there. It was very cumbersome. COMs were slow. Okay, they're a bit faster in PowerShell 5, but it was slow. And the scripts you wrote against these COM objects nearly look like Visual Basic scripts, and I definitely don't want to do that anymore. So there's another way of doing that. In Windows forms, you have something that is called these .NET chart controls. They are, in fact, doing somewhat the same as what was available in MS Chart. And somebody, Boo Prox, of course, who else, started a module on that. So he has a number of out commandlets in there. He's not using the COM object anymore. He's just using those .NET controls. So what he does, he uses a Windows form and he puts those .NET chart controls in there, and that creates your graph. One short example here. And as you can see, the coding here is a lot simpler as if you would be coding against MS Chart. The only thing that creates your graphic is this last line, this outline chart. And he has a number of those. Outline chart, out pie chart, and so on. I think 20, 30 of them. It's very early. He started that last October, if I'm not mistaken. But it already produces some useful input. There are a few bugs in there, of course. It's very early. I only ask for two series. And as you can see in the legend, there is a third series, which I don't know where it comes from. But okay, it's being developed, but it's. I think there is a future in this thing. And Bo is, in fact, asking if people are interested to participate or even give feedback. So definitely have a look at this one. But then for the real stuff, the one that I'm using most of the time for ad hoc charting, I use Excel. And there's a very good module available, Import Excel from Doc Finke. Has anybody ever used Import Excel in the house? Okay, quite a few. Nice. Now, Import Excel is quite interesting. You have probably seen scripts in the past where they code against an Excel object. It was a COM object. You had to count cells where stuff needed to come in your environment. You didn't want to do that, to be honest. So this one is a lot easier. What Doug has done, he used the DLL. So in fact, you don't even need to install Excel on the station anymore. It uses this DLL, and it can provide all this functionality. The module is available on the gallery, so if you want to give it a try, latest version is 2.4. Give it a try. It's quite useful, not only for graphing, but also for standard Excel-related work. As you can see in the module, there's a number of commandlets, and one of these is Export Excel, as we see there on the third line. There's a number of switches and options in the parameters that he has available. I love them because in the past you all had these columns of the same size. Now you can do auto size, you can do auto filter, so you can go immediately and triage your data on specific values or multiple. So it's quite user-friendly even without the graphs. Just give it a try, quite handy. This is another example where I added a bit more functionality in extracting. So remember that we looked at that data where we split it up or grouped it by minute. I'm doing the same thing again. So the group object is again there on the minutes. What I'm doing now, I'm just adding another switch, free stop row. If you scroll through this, you know Excel, this will stick. It's quite easy to work with, quite easy to produce useful spreadsheets, which is most of the time what we're using for working with data in that way. But still no pretty pictures, I'm afraid. We'll get to that. What he did in his latest release, and that is a change for the ones who used an earlier release, in 2.4 he added a new commandlet, and it gives you a lot of possibilities to define what should be in your chart. So he added this commandlet new Excel chart, but instead of talking about it like this, let's have a look at an example. So what you see here is that, I'll just click it through. We have a new commandlet at the top, and in there you just define how your chart in the Excel spreadsheet should look. So in this case, it's quite simple. We define what should be on the x-axis, and we define what should be on the y-axis. That definition you later on refer in your export Excel, where you add a new key, a new parameter, and you refer back to that chart that you just defined. Now, what this produces is quite straightforward. It just, like we said, it has the minutes here on your x-axis. That's what we asked. And it has these values that arrived in the average CPU usage on your y-axis. So that's already a very straightforward, simple way. In my opinion, it's not a long script. You can throw something together like that in a matter of minutes and have something that your managers can look at, because they're definitely not going to look at those numbers. They want those pretty pictures on the right of your spreadsheet. Now, you can go a lot further. There were a lot of default values in that chart that we produced. I left out a few lines because otherwise it wouldn't fit on my slide here. But what is important here, and I'm using splatting at the top there to define my chart. Besides the X and the Y axis, I now also define a title. I give another type, Area 3D, for example. And I give a header for the series. Now, the rest of the code is nearly the same. So this is what we changed versus the first one. And what comes out of this is that we now have a bit more information available in our chart. We have a title, we labeled in our legend the series that we're displaying with the correct label, which is the VM name in this case. So even with a simple line and a few parameters, we can also already customize our graph or chart that we produced in a very convenient way. There's a lot of information already in such a simple graph that we produced with a rather simple script in this case. Another example here. Instead of having one line, we were only looking at one VM. We can have multiple VMs in the same graph. What we're doing here is just changing in the chart definition, again, splitting. We specify that we want to look at all, or five in this case, VMs, and look at the values for that in our chart. So if we look at this, you already have a bit more. He even does the color coding. You have the five graphs. Okay, I didn't label the series, unfortunately, I see. But you have already a much more complex graph. But again, not a lot of coding. Very straightforward, out of the box, and easy to produce. So if you want to produce some pretty looking graphs, this is at the moment my favorite way of doing it. And it's quite straightforward to produce useful visuals of your performance. You can go, of course, a lot further and make these very complex new chart commandlets. That, in fact, covers most of what I wanted to say about the stats. So now we're going for something completely different. we're going to talk about containers. The reason why I added this in the last minute, I was attending one of the container sessions. It was about Windows containers, but the type of container host doesn't really matter. When somebody in the audience asked, why would you use containers? And I was working on this thing, what I'll show you in a minute already. And I thought this would be a good example why you would be using containers. So the reason I tackled this a couple of weeks, or started tackling this a couple of weeks ago, is because containers become more and more grown up. They used to be rather adventurous to work with. They had some issues that you couldn't easily solve. But containers have a lot of advantages, in my opinion. They take away a lot of that overhead. Patching, I don't do patching on my containers. I just upload a new image of the container, which is patched. I only have to take care of the apps, what I actually want to do. Communication between the containers, as we can see later on, is quite straightforward and is based on always, or most of the time, the same concept. So we can reuse a lot of our code. What I did, and now we come to the small thing I throw together in the last couple of weeks. I had a real issue where I'm doing standby. Most of you probably are doing standby duty for your enterprise. You get a call, there's an issue on an environment. Normal procedure, you log on remotely, you start up whatever tool you're using, and you look at the tool. Problem is, your operators are looking at the same tool, but their version, their instance, so you're not sharing data. So I wanted to have a solution that could be shared easily, remotely, local, and that could be used by straightforward tools like, in this case, a web browser, HTTP, HTTPS interface. So I've been looking at the container host. Okay, since I'm a bit inclined towards VMware vSphere, I used Photon as my container host, but you could use whatever container host that you like. It could be your Windows container host or whatever Linux box. That doesn't really play in this thing. I used PowerShell / PowerCLI Core. They are both available, still both in beta, so watch out. I used somewhere to store my data, and without knowing a lot about databases, I used InfluxDB because it's rather straightforward to use. And I used Grafana, which is another tool for my graphical interface. So schematically, it looks like this. It's quite straightforward. I have this host container host here at the bottom, which is the Photon instance. That's I have that as a template available in my environment. So rolling out one of those, a new one, is a matter of seconds / minutes. That is playing a Docker container host. So it's quite easy then, once I have that running automatically, to install on the left my InfluxDB, Grafana for the graphical part. And then I have a container, which we can, I think, does VMware provide a container with? Yes, they provide the one with the core and the PowerShell core in there as well. So you can just install that container without further ado. My script runs, of course, in this environment, which is quite handy. And the only thing I use to communicate with the other two is REST API. And my consumers are at the top. They use HTTP, HTTPS to look at, most of the time, the Grafana interface that is available. Okay, this recaps a bit one of the use cases that I was looking for. So like I mentioned, somebody gets a call, you fire up one of these beauties, and you immediately have data available of the last hour, specific data. You can customize it via an interface. We use the Grafana dashboards. We can add rows on demand with a PowerShell script, commandlet even. I wrote some functions for that. So just a quick look here. This is the part, this is the small script. Okay, those remove InfluxDB and new InfluxDB and so on, import InfluxDB, are some commandlets I wrote, functions I wrote. So this is actually a script that uploads 15 minutes of performance data into an InfluxDB database. That runs on that PowerShell, PowerCLI core. quite straightforward. And then you create a dashboard from a template. So what I did is I have some basic templates that I created in advance. I exported those to an XML file. And what you can now do is, okay, you have to specify the time range as well. You just do a new Grafana dashboard. You point to the database, the name of the dashboard, which template you want to use, and there you go immediately. Okay, the graph that you have here is makes no sense. I just used an example, but immediately via a web interface, you have now a view on your performance data that you just uploaded. Now, between the call I got and having this data available, that was 5 minutes. So you get a call on standby duty, boof, you can immediately look together with your operators who are located somewhere completely different. Remember, this is HTTP. You can look at the same data, talk over the phone, and try to find the issue. Now, what you can do is, I have multiple templates. In this case, I use the same template. But when I import such a template with the new Grafana DB row, I can override some of these variables in there. So this one, as we could see, was configured for one hypervisor and one VM. By specifying those parameters on the call, I can just make a similar graph based on the same template, but for completely different entities. And it adds a row in your Grafana dashboard. So if you, while you're discussing the issue, have a need to see another hypervisor, other VMs, storage, whatever, just pull up a template, specify the parameters, and there you go. You immediately have the same kind of graph with that specific data, even with a legend and so on. So you have nearly instant performance graphs at your disposal, which you can easily share with people sitting in other remote locations. Yes. I always start from an empty VM because it only is minutes to have it running. But you could keep one running, but then you have the problem of the retention of the data. That's why I decided in the end to start from scratch every time. So I start with an empty environment. It's also meant to have an ad hoc view on your performance data. It's not meant. You can use Grafana to have regular inputs and use it over time to map your performance, but that's not why I used it. REST API. So, and for Grafana and for InfluxDB, I used the REST API, which is quite straightforward. Yes, yes. Except for the upload of the multiple data points in InfluxDB, there you have to go to a binary upload, because otherwise he misinterprets the data. If you do it by single data points, it will take a lot of time, so you better put them together in per 1,000 or 5,000 observations per block. Now, like I said, I wrote some functions about that. You saw some of the calls. Just for the fun, I'm going to put them on GitHub so you can all have a look. If there's a need or somebody says, this sounds useful, I could even throw them in a module, which makes it perhaps a bit easier to use. What is also interesting is, like I showed, you start from some basic templates, which is nothing more than an XML file. I estimated that with max 10 of those basic templates, I could see or produce most of the graphs I'm constantly using. So that could be a collection as well, because you can parameterize them. When you upload them in a row or in a dashboard, you can actually say which entities you want to display in the graph. It's just the layout of the graph that is in the template. You can also build them from scratch. Now, what is also interesting, there are some triggers that you could use to speed this up. What I do now is I get a call and I log in remotely, fire the script up. But you could automate that stuff, and that's what we're here for, in fact, in these kind of. You could even connect this to a vSphere alarm. You could react on whatever SNMP trap you receive somewhere and fire it up. And this is the one that I'm actually working on at the moment. There are some Slack robots around where you can send commands via the core to your vSphere environment. So what I'm thinking of doing is using one of those robots, send the commands, and he will fire off the dashboard with a convenient route in there. And then he will even return me the HTTP, the URL, where I can consult my Grafana interface. So automation, like I would like to have it all the time, of course. There's a lot of possibilities in there, I think. I would welcome some feedback if people think this is a useful thing. For me, it was just playing around with containers, but it became more than just playing around with containers, to be honest. I think there's actually some use cases that could be done with this kind of coding. Like I said, this was a light version. My previous session was a bit more code line, so I kept it quite light. There's some takeaways here in this session. I open doors in this case. A picture says more than 1,000 words. A graph most of the time shows you a lot better than a long table or text what is really happening in your environment. What I also wanted to show is that PowerShell has a lot of that functionality that you need to handle this kind of stuff is already built in. So don't go reinventing that stuff. Remember those commandlets that are there that are very useful for handling that data. Also, don't travel around. Pick one solution. In my case, I use most of the time the import Excel module from Duck. That does most of the stuff that I want. And then my last discovery there, containers seem to be an ideal fit for some of the use cases that I encounter, and I suspect most of the people that handle a vSphere environment encounter from time to time as well. There's a disclaimer at the bottom. We only scratched, like I said, it's very light. We only scratched some of the solutions. There's tons of other solutions out there. I'm not saying that the only ones you should look at are the ones I presented here. Again, there's a 15-minute break, but I think there's lunch as well. Yeah. Okay, so it's more than a 15-minute break. Grab a coffee, have some food. Are there any questions? After the beer crawl yesterday evening. Chrissy? Okay. So I have one fan of creating a module out of these functions. Okay, your wish is my command. Any other questions? Yes? Grafana is, in fact, only the visualization part. There's another sexy graph. It's an application from two French guys who use the same graphical interface. Grafana needs a number of data sources, one data source. One of the possibilities is Influx, but it can be any. There's quite a bunch of data sources that it accepts. I just run it in a container. It's a container thing. Yeah, you have to get your container from somewhere, but if you have your local repository. Does that answer your, yeah, okay. I think it needs a data source. Like I said, I only started playing a couple of, I'm not sure if it can run standalone, because most of the implementations with Grafana that I saw, they have an underlying data source. But you can select, there's X number of possibilities there. Yes. The Grafana command? Yeah. No, those are functions I wrote, which I'm going to put in a module on request of His Majesty at the back there. No, it's something I wrote, but it's very straightforward, REST APIs. In fact, I'm reusing my REST API core function that I used in X number of other modules. It's just adapting the URI that you have to pass. That's it. Any more questions? Otherwise, I will be around till this afternoon. Hit me or talk to me in the outside. Thank you. There's some.